In this work, we introduce a machine learning approach to assess student group collaboration using individual level behavioral cues. Earlier this year, we developed a multimodal behavior analysis conceptual model that offers different levels of abstraction and inference of student groups collaborating on various tasks in a classroom setting. The motivation for developing such an automated framework was to provide constructive feedback to teachers, as it is very difficult for teachers to simultaneously monitor and evaluate every student in the classroom. Our paper focuses on the development of supervised machine learning models to infer the overall group collaboration quality from individual level roles and individual level behavior annotations. When building these machine learning models, we came across both class imbalance and limited training data challenges. These challenges are clearly highlighted through the level A label distributions shown on the left side. For our experiments, we explored both video and audio plus video modality settings. Training machine learning models directly on this data resulted in us obtaining the test set confusion matrices shown on the right. We can easily tell that the trained models are biased, as the test set predictions are more inclined towards the categories with the greatest number of samples. Data balancing and data augmentation techniques are useful to address these types of challenges. Please note that the label space in our problem exhibits an ordered structure, and the distribution is similar to a normal distribution. It is in fact quite common to observe a normal distribution for this kind of data. Knowing the fact that our label space exhibits an ordered structure, we propose a variant of the regular categorical cross-entropy loss and call it the ordinal cross-entropy loss. This variant helps impose a higher penalty on misclassified samples during the training process. To address the limited training data and imbalanced label distribution challenges, we propose using a controlled variant of the popular mix-up data augmentation technique. The motivation for using mix-up stems from the fact that deep learning models are better calibrated, trained with samples generated using mix-up. This slide describes the proposed ordinal cross-entropy loss. The main difference from the regular cross-entropy loss function is the additional weight that is multiplied to the cross-entropy loss term. Since the ground truth label vector is represented as a one-hot coded vector, the regular cross-entropy loss function only focuses on the predicted probability corresponding to the ground truth label, and the predicted probabilities of the rest of the classes is ignored. With this in mind, W helps capture the absolute difference between the true label index and the predicted label index during the training process. If a training sample is correctly classified, then W will be equal to zero, and the ordinal cross-entropy loss behaves exactly as the regular cross-entropy loss function. However, for misclassified samples, a larger penalty is imposed that's proportional to how far the predicted label is from its true label location. Next, we will look at the controlled mix-up augmentation technique. The mix-up augmentation technique consists of generating additional data samples by linearly combining different training sample pairs. Both the input feature variable and the output variables are linearly combined to generate additional samples. By using different lambda values, one can create different samples from the same pair of training samples, with lambda being randomly sampled from a beta distribution. To have more control over this process, we can create additional samples for a specific category by controlling the range of lambda. This can be done using a threshold parameter represented here as tau. Setting tau greater than 0.5 ensures that the generated sample will be dominated by the category for which we want to create more samples. For our experiments, we used a simple five-layer multi-layer perceptron model. Our model's design was based on Fawaz et al.'s paper that compares the performance of different neural network models on various one-dimensional datasets. For features, we compute normalized histogram representations of the level B2 and level C codes that were assigned to each student in the group for the duration of each task. Level B2 codes consist of fixed length 1 minute segments, making it easier for us to compute the histogram representation. However, level C contains variable length segments. To compute the normalized histogram for level C, we scan and compile all the codes observed after every 0.1 seconds. For training the MLP models, we follow a leave one group cross-validation protocol. Next, we will look at the main benefits observed using the proposed techniques. Here we see the average weighted F1 score performance for four cases under different parameter settings. The blue and orange bars represent the performance of the cross-entropy loss function without and with class balancing. Similarly, the brown and green bars show the proposed ordinal cross-entropy loss function's performance without and with class balancing. For each parameter setting, we see little or no benefit in using the class balancing technique. However, we do see significant improvements in the overall F1 score performance when using the ordinal cross-entropy loss under the different parameter settings. In this slide, we show the benefit of using mix-up augmentation without and with the ordinal cross-entropy loss function. We calculate the average weighted F1 score performance under different threshold values and under different number of samples generated for each class using mix-up augmentation. We observe that for most cases, mix-up augmentation and the ordinal cross-entropy loss function complement each other, thereby helping us improve the overall performance. Here we show the qualitative performance of the different cases explored in the previous slides. Please note that since we used a leave one group out cross-validation approach, we did not see any test samples for the working independently category in the video modality and the effective category for the audio plus video modality setting. This is because all data samples corresponding to these categories belong to just one group and were not observed in other groups. Therefore, rows corresponding to these categories in the confusion matrices shown here have all zero values. Here we show results for four cases. The first case shows the test set confusion matrix for MLP models trained using the regular cross-entropy loss function with class balancing. The second case evaluates the performance of using the proposed ordinal cross-entropy loss with class balancing. In the third case, we evaluate the controlled mix-up augmentation technique with the regular cross-entropy loss function. And finally, in the fourth case, we explore using the mix-up augmentation technique together with the ordinal cross-entropy loss function. For cases 1 and 2, despite using class balancing, we notice that the dataset imbalance problem persists. However, we do observe little robustness in the second case, where we use the ordinal cross-entropy loss function. This is attributed to the higher penalty being imposed on the misclassified samples during the training process. In cases 3 and 4, we observe a better diagonal structure in the confusion matrices, which we could not see in the previous two cases. This indicates that the mix-up data augmentation technique is helping address the limited data and imbalanced label distribution challenges. In case 3, we notice that certain test sample predictions for the effective and working independently categories are being classified as progressive. We are able to better handle this issue by using the ordinal cross-entropy loss along with mix-up augmentation, as seen in the fourth case. Mix-up augmentation technique and the ordinal cross-entropy loss function complement each other and help get better test set predictions. For future work, we plan to explore other paths described in the conceptual model and also investigate how the individual student roles and individual student behaviors contribute towards the overall group collaboration quality. We plan on doing this by computing separate histogram and temporal representations for each student in the group. You can find more details about our approach in the final ECCV proceedings or through our archive paper. For any questions with respect to our paper, please feel free to contact us by email. Thank you.